Hi, I'm Vanessa, and I love bad Star Trek. I break down bad episodes of my favorite show so you don't have to watch it. I will be the Amazon headdress at Bonnaroo, that is Star Trek the Original Series. Today, I will be talking to you about an episode called The Paradise Syndrome. I once had this very soberly inspired idea. Like, what if you just had a boiling pot of ingredients over a fire and kept feeding it more and more tomatoes, more onions, more duck liver, and more eyeballs? And when it gets low from evaporation and constantly simmering from being eaten, you just add more broth and more potatoes to the soup. Could you theoretically make a forever soup? Constantly cooking, constantly changing. And the fact is that this exists already, and it's called a perpetual stew. So what the hell does that have to do with anything? Well, this episode is bad in every possible way a Star Trek episode can be. The levels of racism here are unbelievable and egregious. Dear Doctor demonstrated racism between humans and other aliens, and the Paradise Syndrome, on the other hand, straightforwardly demonstrates and justifies racism towards Native Americans. Just when you think you have a bead on how racist it is, it gets worse. Listen, I'm a white woman, and I'm probably gonna fuck up in some places talking about this, and I'm not trying to speak on anyone else's behalf. But I think certain things are objectively terrible, like red face, like showing indigenous cultures as monolithic and indistinct from each other, the sexist and awful Indian princess trope, like portraying Native American people as less evolved than white people, meaning they're infantilized and shown as simple-minded. And of course, worst of all, Natives are shown as entirely unable and incapable of surviving without the white man's help. So, of course, the failsafe that often carries the original series through its worst episode, which is the chemistry between Spock, Kirk, and Bones, buckles under the weight under one of the most fucked up episodes Star Trek has ever made. Similar to Up the Long Ladder, a white woman wrote this, named Margaret Arman, and I scoured the IMDb profiles of the supporting Native cast, and all of them appear to be white. So that means that not a single Native American person looks to have been consulted about this or casted. And why would white people feel entitled to step in and tell the story of people whose collective of cultures and traditions are often known for storytelling? This is certainly not the last example of that in Star Trek. Even if Beltran is Latindio, white writers came up with his culture on the show. What interests could white people be protecting by going around a marginalized group to literally speak for them? In The Paradise Syndrome, the answer to that question could not be more obvious, that by making issues that natives face into the white man's burden, they come out the hero. Stories have that kind of power. This narrative lives on today, where marginalized people need to smile and nod as their humanity gets piecemealed back to them by people who pat themselves on the back for performative bullshit like renaming roads and removing statues and doing nothing substantive to create true equity and throwing natives in jail for protecting their own land. The cringe never stops in this episode, so here's your warning. This episode is really fucking racist, so don't think that the plot or anything is going to save it, because all of it sucks. A landing party consisting of Bones, Spock, and Kirk is exploring a planet called Amerind, and McCoy and Kirk have a flower child moment.
I swear that's honeysuckle I smell.
I swear that's a little orange blossom thrown in.
And Captain Kirk is just so wowed by the planet that McCoy diagnoses him on the spot with something called the Tahiti syndrome.
Just so peaceful. Uncomplicated, no problems, no command decisions. Just living.
Typical human reaction to an idyllic natural setting. Back in the 20th century, we referred to it as the Tahiti syndrome.
which is wanting a vacation. It's not a syndrome. Before coming upon a huge metal obelisk, and Spock scans it and says that it's resistant to probe, but he determines that it's so old that the tricorder can't date it. So these two things contradict each other, don't they? You can scan, but you can date it. Not because you don't know the date, but the numbers don't go back far enough. The year display is like 5 wooden blocks, number 2 through 4. Why the hell not? What is wrong with this thing? And he doesn't know what the writing on the obelisk means. And Spock says, hey, we only have 30 minutes to be down here before we have to rendezvous with an asteroid to blow it up. Because if we don't, this planet is going to be destroyed. And Kirk goes, so you're saying we have a whole half hour. So let's look at this obelisk some more. And across the river, they find the nearest concentration of life, which happens to be an encampment of Native Americans. And we know that with the visual shorthand stereotype of the braids, beads, and buckskins TV trope. Spock says that they're a mixture of Navajo, Mohican, and Delaware natives.
They look like, I'd swear, they're American Indians.
They are, Doctor. A mixture of Navajo, Mohican, and Delaware, I believe.
And Navajo is actually the name that the Spanish gave them, and they call themselves Diné, or the people, and live in the southwest of the United States, whereas Mohicans live in New York State, and Delawares live in Oklahoma. So they all live right on the river on some random planet wearing the same shit, and somehow Spock is able to scan them and know that they're a mixture. Spock's tricorder is really working overtime down here, and Kirk goes, well, are there any more advanced people on the planet capable of building this obelisk?
Mr. Spock, is it possible there's a more evolved civilization somewhere else on this planet? One capable of building that obelisk?
So, I gotta tell you, when I first watched this on my bed, streaming it on Netflix, this is about the point where I hit the space bar and turned it off. They took one look. One look across a river at a group of people and went, nah, they're not capable of building this. Giorgio Tsoukalos, the ancient aliens guy, entered the chat. I'm not saying it was alien, but it was aliens. Spock is engaging in a racist conspiracy theory here that looks at the structures, took a lot of effort to build, and assumes that the people who live near said structure couldn't possibly have built it. The same was said about the pyramids in Egypt. Like, the blocks are too heavy for brown people to lift. Aliens must have done it. The racism is so high-pitched that it's easy to forget that they're meant to blow up an asteroid. But this obelisk is so important that they're delaying doing that. Like, why are they even down there? Why are they even on this planet at all? They didn't even know the obelisk was there until after they beamed down. So they beamed down to hang out and talk about going on vacation while an asteroid is hurtling towards this place. God damn it, this is bad. It's bad on every level. McCoy says, hey, why don't we tell these folks about the asteroid to warn them? And Kirk's like, nah, they're too primitive for them to even have contact with us. Never mind know about the asteroid. You'll just scare them. Kirk, they are human beings. There's no prime directive thing being violated here because of that. He's not even acknowledging that they're human. In Up the Long Ladder, Picard didn't even hesitate to contact the Bring Lloydy, who had chickens and spinning wheels on their planet. So gee, could it be just that they're too brown to understand? And Kirk's like, let's take another look at that obelisk before going and blowing up that giant asteroid. Like, if I was Spock, I'd be like, okay, enough playtime outside, Kirk. We're going home. He can't just look at it. He has to grope the outside, and he uses his communicator to contact the Enterprise. But at that moment, a trapdoor opens up and he falls into the obelisk, and the door seals shut behind him, and he's trapped. And as he pulls himself up on a control panel, he accidentally pushes a button and he zaps himself. And we have the unfortunate experience of watching Captain Kirk have an O-face before being knocked out. So he fell 2 feet and he suddenly became uncoordinated as a drunk toddler. Outside the obelisk, Spock goes, well, we gotta go. He's gone. He made his decision. We gotta go. And McCoy refuses to leave, insists that they stay and focus on getting the captain out of there. And Spock literally holds up 2 rocks and says, if we don't, this rock is going to hit this other rock and destroy it completely unless we leave right now.
Doctor, assume this is the planet we're on. This is the approaching asteroid. If we don't get to that deflection point in time, it will become physically impossible to divert this asteroid.
Asteroid, then captain. So they do leave, and Kirk wakes up and his memory is completely gone. He doesn't know where he is. He doesn't know his own name.
How did I get here? Who am I?
And he approaches the trapdoor from underneath and it just opens up. So he wasn't really trapped. When he climbs out, two native women meet him looking like two buckskin Kardashians to bring offerings to this obelisk they consider a temple. And they literally bow to him and tell him he's a god because he walked through a door just like their legend said.
We are your people. We've been waiting for you to come to us.
And more native people are like, you're a god, oh my god.
Ramani has said that you appeared to her and to her handmaiden from the walls of the temple, just as our legend foretells. We do not doubt the words of our priestess, but these are troubled times.
The chief here is played by a guy named Richard Hale, a white guy whose racial ambiguity got him cast as both Middle Eastern and Native people. And next to him, Salish, played by Rudy Solari, an Italian guy. And the woman who found him, Miramani, is played by Sabrina Scharf. A white former Playboy bunny, and sex work is fine, but of course she's a Playboy bunny, right? Like, she has to be. Kirk goes, well, I did come from the sky, so maybe you're on to something. And Salish is like, well, if you're a god, prove it. And right then, Miramani walks in with a wet kid fished out of a river saying he drowned, and they basically just throw him on a bearskin and go, well, he's not making any noise, so I guess he's dead. And Kirk performs some questionable CPR. Like, let's say no chest compressions like a normal person. It's very leg involved. Pretty sure shaking a kid's thighs isn't gonna get him to breathe again. But it works. And that's how Kirk became God. So for some reason, this means that the metal clitoris that Salish is wearing on his head is going on Kirk's head now. Like, we were stupid and drowning by a river we chose to live next to until a white guy shook our kid's thighs and brought him back from the dead. Thank you, pale-faced white savior. Oh, God. And Miramani later tells Salish, like, yeah, sorry, a white god is here. So I gotta marry him instead of you. It goes, white god, then medicine chief that for priestess marrying. So sorry, go find someone else. And it just so happens that Spock burned out the engines, both getting to the asteroid, as well as trying and failing to route the power from them to the deflectors and phasers to break it apart. So it'll take an entire month to get all the way back and go get Kirk with the asteroid a few hours behind them.
My poor parents.
It's like they tell you the ending already. Miramani brings new clothes into the hut and tells Kirk while he's whittling away at a gourd, like, I'd like you to bathe because you fucking stink. And you've been here a day or two and there's flies on you. But first Kirk wants to know about the wise ones who brought him here. I'd be like, bath first.
The wise ones brought us here from far away. They chose a medicine chief to keep the secret of the temple and to use it when the sky darkens.
So they know they're from somewhere else, but think it's some benevolent god who planted them there. Okay, now let's get this shirt off. Oop, it has no laces. How does it come off?
From father to son.
Yes, how does this open?
We are watching a white person in red face fiddle with a shirt like she's a caveman with a smartphone. Star Trek is at its worst here. And it doesn't get any better when the chief comes into the hut and he's like, yeah, we're a god, so we gotta celebrate you. So what's your name? We gotta know what to chant. And he's like,
Gerald. Jerry. Jer. Guh.
Hurok? Oh, that's me. Boy, he sure is free from responsibility here, and he remarks on how happy he is, like he's never been. So you can't remember your own name, but you know your ass needed to get to a Sandals resort someday, just burning in the back of your head. Most critics hate this episode, but give a pass to Shatner's performance here. I like his acting fine, but I think it's hard to appreciate it because of how fucked up everything is. Like, playing a white savior well, not really that great. Just ask Ryan Gosling after he saved Jazz.
And yes, for those of you who are curious, I was the last person who thought he would save Jazz. I mean, I was like, me, Ryan Gosling, like a white kid from Canada, I guess I can try and save Jazz, so I did.
La La Land is one of the worst movies ever, oh my god. But like, we have a white guy falling from the sky, assumed to be a god on sight, sent from the wise ones who put them there, and getting married to the chief's daughter, a priestess, which plays into the Indian maiden stereotype where a woman with swarthy skin and Eurocentric features is both virginal and sexually available, which is extremely fucked. Because according to the Coalition to Stop Violence Against Native Women, 4 out of 5 Native women experience violence. And the murder rate for Indigenous women, girls, and Two-Spirit is 10 times that of the national average. Homicide is the 3rd leading cause of death among those 10 to 24 years of age. This fetishizing narrative is amongst the only that non-natives see of this culture. And that refusal to acknowledge their basic humanity makes them awfully disposable to some. Anyone in the audience want to take a real big swing at how this ends? Because I just gave you a big metal forehead clit of a clue. On Amerind, it's clear that some time has passed because Kurok is wearing prosthetic sideburns like suns through the hourglass. These are the hairs on her face. And Kirk is like, wow, man, this resort has everything.
I have found paradise. Surely no man has ever attained such happiness.
See, all you gotta do is wear moccasins and have paint on your face, and you too can be a fucking god to these people. There is something very white New Age about this, like indigenousness is just a state of mind, man. But Salish isn't buying it and tries to get him with a letter opener, and when he cuts him with it, he's like, ooh, a god bleeds.
Bleed, Kurok. Behold a god who bleeds.
But he's real jelly of this white man taking his chick, and so they fight, and we know Will Shatner isn't drop kicking anybody, but he does. Before marrying Miramani, and we get a frolicking through the woods montage, followed by Kirk talking about how happy he is, but he's starting to get his memory back and knows that he doesn't really belong on this planet. And I gotta really hand it to Shatner for a fly being on his face for a distressingly long time during his ellipse-filled monologue and not even twitching. He doesn't even twitch. That is a professional. And his Indian princess says, hey, I'm pregnant. So Kurok is so excited. And by the way, this feels very Pocahontas-like, which is a racist myth about a girl who defied her family to save a white guy from her native tribe, when the reality was that her name is Maruaka, and at 15 she was kidnapped and raped and impregnated by colonists who forced her to deny her own culture before dragging her to England, where she died of tuberculosis. It makes you wonder who the real primitives are. So now Kurok's gotta put his buckskin where his mouth is and gotta do the god thing because the sky's gone dark, which I guess means they kinda did know about the asteroid already. That's what she said. And when it doesn't do anything, Salish is like, look, he's not a god. Not just jelly, he's a liar. Spock and McCoy are caricatures of themselves during this whole thing and stressing out Scotty about how much damage they're doing to the engine and butting heads about how much sleep Spock isn't getting while he's trying real hard to crack the code of what's on the obelisk, which he just figures out as they get back to the planet and beam down to pick up Kirk as he and his wife are being stoned to death for being liars and being married to a liar. And guess who dies, you guys? Which has to happen because Kirk is definitely leaving on the Enterprise. A native woman's death is a plot device, and the woman whose character was nothing but in service of a white guy the entire time, with her dying words literally being, thank you for saving us, Spock mind melds with Kirk and gets his memory back, and Miramani is shoved to the side like dirty laundry. They literally don't even move her body out of the way when the temple door opens. By, get this.
The key must be in these symbols. We've got to decipher them.
I already have to some extent, Captain. They are musical notes.
You mean entry can be gained by playing certain notes on a musical instrument?
That would be one method. Another would be a series of tonal qualities spoken in their proper sequence.
Give me your communicator. Kirk to Enterprise.
Aye, Captain.
Kirk talking on his communicator. The tones of his voice open the door, so he was the chosen one all along. And Spock reactivates the deflector that broke because Kirk broke it when he put his stupid fat head in the damn thing. I didn't even get into the Wise Ones being some kind of humanoid seed super race, like Superman meets Johnny Appleseed, saving primitive peoples from extinction by planting them elsewhere. Like, there's no part of this that is insanely racist. People that are native don't dress like this in everyday life. They wear what everybody else. So skip this terrible, shit-filled, perpetual stew of an episode. Native people do exist. 570-ish Native American groups. Like, the plot is so terrible. And everything that makes the original series great suffers because of it. There is not one redeeming quality about this episode between Chakotay's characterization written by white people and this episode. Native American representation in Star Trek is a blight on the franchise that needs to be fixed. Pronto. And for this Thanksgiving, in addition to hanging out with family, if you take anything away from this, if you're white like me, try to learn about who originally inhabited the land you live on and find mutual aid funds to donate time and money to. Like, subscribe, no pressure, but peer pressure. Till next time, I guess.